Good afternoon. In the last lecture, we discussed about Gauss's law of electrostatics, and if you remember, I repeat here. For any given closed surface, electric flux is equal to the total charge enclosed by the surface. So this is basically electric flux, and this is the Gauss's law of electrostatics. We discussed about integral and differential form of Gauss's law, and then we discussed about equivalence of Coulomb's law and Gauss's law. This is, in one way you can say, the Gauss's law is another form of Coulomb's law, which can be used to determine the electric field due to a given charge distribution. Now, if you remember, in the first part, in the first application of Gauss's law, we have determined electric field due to a point charge. Now, in the second, we will discuss electric field due to try to determine electric field due to an infinite light charge. And what is given to us? We are given a very thin infinite length wire, and I assume that this is my z axis. So this wire is lying along the z axis. And then rho L is the line charge density, is the line charge density. It means rho L is infinite length wire, very thin. Okay, so this is very thin wire. Now we wanted to know that what is the electric field due to this line element at a distance r from this element. So what we do for this, because when we implement the Gauss's law of electrostatics, what do you need in the statement of the Gauss's law? You require a closed surface, and you calculate the total electric flux passing through that closed surface is equal to the total charge enclosed by that surface. So here we will consider a Gaussian surface which is cylinder of length L. Okay, so how we consider this? We consider a cylinder of length L. Now due to this, this is radius R. Okay, so this is the cylinder and the radius is R and the length is L. Fine. Now, what we wanted to know, we wanted to know that what is the electric field at a distance R from this line. So this is our Gaussian surface S. Now when we implement the Gauss's law, what we do? One more thing, the electric field here in cylindrical, because we use a cylindrical coordinate, so coordinate system we will use is the electric field would be written as ERA, that would be rho, because in our notation we have considered rho, so keep it like this, rho, rho. Okay, so E rho, A rho plus E phi, A phi plus Ez Az. Okay. Now according to the symmetry of the problem, if you look at this, this wire is infinite in extension. So there is no electric field along the z direction. There is no electric field along the, and this has a symmetry with respect to phi. So this is uniform. So in net result, electric field will be only along the direction of rho or radius of the cylinder. Fine. So this is what electric field is, or you can say, or this statement can be written as E dot ds Q enclosed by epsilon naught, since D equals to epsilon E. Okay, so using this. Now here, okay, more thing you require. You require the value of ds in cylindrical coordinate system. Now if you remember in cylindrical coordinate system, right here, ds is a rho, a phi, and a z. Okay, this is h2, h3, and if you remember in cylindrical coordinate system, h1 is 1, h2 is rho, and h3 is 1. Okay, so h2, h3 would be rho, then u1, u2 and u3 are rho, phi, and z. Okay, so these are the values. So here we will substitute the values. Anyway, if I write the formula first, then it would be better. H2, H3, du2, du3, a1 plus h1, h3, du1, du3, a2 plus h1, h2, du1, du2, du3. So substitute the values, you get here, this is rho, and then du2 is d phi dz a rho plus h1 h3 d rho dz a phi plus h1 h2, which is rho, then d phi d rho as that. Okay, this is, now if I calculate E dot ds, the dot product of this with this, so these two components will not contribute, only the first will contribute, so you will have a result E rho into rho d phi dz simply. Okay? Then when I substitute these values here in the integral, then this becomes dz equals to q, the total charge enclosed. Okay, now when I look at the diagram anyway, because I have removed the diagram, but when I say q enclosed is the L length of the line element is enclosed in that cylinder, so this is L multiplied by rho I. Okay, because this is the length and this is the charge per unit length, so this would be appearing here rho L into I. Now when I look at this integration goes for phi and z. So this is basically, you can write this as a z equals to 0 to L and phi equals to 0 to pi. Then E rho, you can keep it out. Okay. And rho is also constant. Okay. So this becomes 2 pi rho L equals to rho L into R. Fine. Now you can calculate the value of U. So rho L, sorry, this remains there. This L and this L gets cancelled. So this becomes 2 pi rho. So this is the value of first component of your electric field, and then finally your result electric field would become rho L 2 pi rho A rho. So this is electric field due to an infinite line element which is lying along the z axis. So this is how your Gauss's law is used to determine the electric field due to an infinite line charge. Fine? Now the third application we will talk about . Now we will try to calculate the electric field inside and outside of a uniformly charged sphere. Okay? Now suppose if you are given a sphere, okay? This is an spherical shape and the charge density, this is uniformly charged sphere, so volume charge density.
Because the electric field has only radial components, so when I take the dot product of E and ds,
only the first component will be required there, because the other two components in the electric field is already are already zero. So the remaining component of the area vector will not contribute. Okay, so I am not writing this. They are not required for this analysis. Now in case of spherical, h1 is 1, h2 is r, and h3 is r sin theta, and u1 is r, u2 is r theta, and u3 is y. This is theta. Okay. So when I write ds, this comes out to be h2 h3, so which is r square sin theta d theta and d phi. Right? This is the value of your, and then of course this is there. So when I write the left hand side, E dot ds, now this S is what? This S is this spherical surface of radius r, which is inside the given sphere. This is your given sphere, okay? So this becomes 2 integrals, okay? And then this is ER r square sin theta d theta d phi, okay? Now when you look at this, this is theta equals to and phi equals to. Now theta equals to 0 to pi and phi equals to 0 to 2 pi. Okay. Now in this case, this becomes finally ER into 4 pi r square. Okay. Because r is constant on that surface, the value of r, because we are integrating on the surface, and the value of r remains constant throughout. So we are integrating with respect to theta and phi. So 2 pi will come over here. So this is the answer. Then right hand side, Q enclosed will be the total charge enclosed divided by epsilon naught. So when I say epsilon, total charge, now what is the total charge enclosed by this surface? This will be the volume of this sphere multiplied by the density. So this becomes, so when I substitute the values in the statement of Gauss's law, then this becomes ER 4 pi r square equals to 4 by 3, this has to be r square, because we are talking about this charge. So the charge enclosed by this surface, so this is 4 by 3 pi r cube into rho v, because 4 by 3 pi r cube is the volume multiplied by this area. Okay, so value of ER will be 4 rows of pi and pi r square and cube. So this becomes ER equals to 1 by 3 rho v into r. Okay? So this is the value, and I substituted it in the expression of electric field, and this becomes rho v over 3 r into ar. So this is the value of when r is less than a. This is the value of electric field inside the uniformly charged sphere of radius a. Right? In the similar way, we can determine the value of the electric field outside the sphere. Okay? Now for that case, the analysis remains same, things will remain same, because the statement will remain same, the coordinate system will remain same. So the value of the only difference would appear here is for the second case. If I just write it down, this will also remain same. Okay, the only difference would be I will consider a Gaussian surface outside, and now this is the radius r. Okay, now when I calculate I do it here, case second, when r is greater than a. In this case, this E dot ds will be Q enclosed by epsilon naught. Now this Q enclosed is the total charge enclosed by your Gaussian surface, and now the Gaussian surface is enclosing the whole sphere given to you. So this becomes 4 by 3 pi a cube into rho. That would be the difference. Okay, the left hand side remains same, because this integral will remain same. So this is ER 4 pi r square will be the result, and then this would be 4 by 3 pi a cube. So from here we will get a result, this 4 pi goes off, the remaining thing 1 by 3 a cube by r square rho. So this is the value, and when I substitute it in the electric field, this becomes r cube rho v a r. So this is the value of electric field when r is greater than a.
This is how we can use the Gauss's law to determine the electric field. This is inside the charge sphere and this is outside the charge sphere. Okay, and you can see the difference. The inside the sphere anyway, it is proportional to the radius, and outside it is inversely proportional to the radius square. Okay, it is inversely in writing. This is r square. So this is how we can use Gauss's law to determine the electric field for any given surface. So what is the basic idea here? You can use Gauss's law to determine the electric field for any given charge distribution. The only thing you require is you need to find out an appropriate Gaussian surface and choose an appropriate coordinate system. Write or represent your Gauss's law in the chosen coordinate system and then solve the integral. You will get the components of the electric field in all the direction wherever it exists. Okay, so this is what the application of Gauss's law. There are many more applications which you can solve. So those you will try yourself, and then if any difficulty appears, you may discuss that in the class. Okay. Now coming to the next topic, which is electrostatic potential. Now as you remember, we have already defined the electric field. An electric field is due to a charge q is given by this expression. If you remember, k q over r square radius. Okay, so for a given charge, for a point charge, now and the force also, we have also calculated the force anyway, and you can also represent the force on any charge q in the presence of an electric field is given by this expression, right? Now when I am considering, suppose if I calculate the work done in moving a charge by some distance, okay, in the presence of an electric field. So there is an electrostatic force which exists, and you need to do some work on the charged particle to move it. Okay, work done in moving a charge q, right? So in this case I can write tw is equals to f dot, because I am writing the f dot dr is the work done in moving a charge in presence of the force by a distance dl. Okay, now if I substitute the value qe, and this is the work done, okay, or you can say work done is basically qe dot dl moving from a to b. So suppose if you are moving a charged particle bearing a charge q from point A to point B in the presence of an electric field E, then the total work done is given by this expression. Now if I calculate that is W by Q, then it becomes A to B E dot dl. And this is what we denote as a VAB. Okay? Or you can say this as a potential at B with
with respect to point A. So in general, the definition of potential is, now we can define this potential with respect to a point where the where the potential is completely zero, basically. So we can define it in some way that we are bringing a point charge from infinity to a certain location. In that case, we can define it as a potential at any point is defined as that we are bringing a particle from let's put the value of electric field first and then we'll substitute it, because we have an electric field 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught q over r square ar. Okay, and then when I calculate the value here, that will be tr. Okay, this becomes finally, when I solve it, this gives me V minus RA RB, or I can say this is 4 pi epsilon naught with a minus sign, then RA to RB 1 upon R square, Q is also can be taken outside or near. Okay, so when I solve this integral, this becomes 1 over or q over 4 pi epsilon naught, and this becomes minus 1 by r. And this is rb. So this becomes q 4 pi epsilon naught. This will be positive, okay, because minus 1 by r square, when I integrate it, it will give you 1 by r square will be giving you minus 1 by r. And this minus and minus will be compensated. So this is 1 over RB minus 1 over R. And this is the value of V identity. Fine? So this is the potential at point P, B with respect to the point A. Now suppose if I choose A tending to infinite, in that case VB simply is the potential at any point defined by, so this becomes RB minus 0. So this VB becomes simply Q 4 pi epsilon naught RB. Okay, or in general we can define potential as Q over 4 pi epsilon naught R. So this is the amount of work done in moving a unit charge from infinity to a location R. Okay? Now why we are choosing infinite as a reference point? Because at infinite there is no electric field, or we assume that it is zero. Electric field is zero at that point. Okay? So bringing a unit charge from a point where the potential is zero to a point where the potential is something. So we calculate it with respect to some point. Okay, we can always calculate potential with respect to some other point, or we can calculate potential with respect to infinite also. So this is given as, now suppose if you are given a line charge element, then Q can be replaced by always, in that case of course the value will be given to you is rho L. In that case your V will be 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught r and rho l dl, and there will be an integration like that. Okay, now if instead of a line charge, if you are given a surface charge, then in that case V can be replaced as surface charge 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught r, and then this would be rho s. Okay, and similarly, if I have and this P would be V rho V dV 4 pi epsilon naught. So these are the values of electric potential due to
various charge distributions. Means, suppose you don't have the discrete charges, or you don't have charge located at a single point, the charge is uniformly distributed over the surface, then it may be either a line element, or means the charge is uniformly distributed on a length, or charge is uniformly distributed on a surface, or charge is distributed on a volume. So either of the case, anyway, in any of the case, you can use an appropriate definition of potential. Now this is very simple idea, because when I open this integration, this gives me the total charge there. So instead of this Q, we can always replace rho L d. Q can be replaced always by rho L d L or rho S d S or rho V d V. Okay, this we have already discussed when we discussed the Coulomb's law. So this is about the electrostatic potential. Now we talk about relationship between electric field and electric potential, okay? Now we have both the definitions with us. Electric field is defined as, for a point charge, electric field E is okay, and electrostatic potential is 4 pi epsilon naught r. Okay, this is vector. Now we want to establish a relationship between these two. So for that purpose, I need to choose a very simplest case, Cartesian system. Since we assume that electric field is also a function of xyz and V is also a function of xyz, because in both the cases we know that electric field and potential both are functions of position coordinates. Fine. Now what we do here, as we know, the potential V is represented as E dot dl, okay? As just now we have defined it, that what is electrostatic potential? It is work done in moving a unit charge from infinite to a location. So this is just a differential of potential I have written here, which is E dot dl, okay? Because this is a very simple thing. Now when I write this, so I should write it here, E dot. Now if I write it in Cartesian coordinate system, this becomes minus ex dx plus ey dy plus ez dz with a minus sign. So this is the value of d. Okay. Now if I use the definition, or if I use the calculus in defining dv for this function, which is a scalar function of xyz, then I can always write this as a del v by del x into dx plus del v by del y into dy and del v by del z and dz. Okay, now compare these two, because both are giving you the definition of dv or expressions of dv. Now when I compare these two line by line, means what? When I compare anyway, what I can do, I can compare the coefficients of and dz. Then when I do this, this gives me ex equals to minus del v by del x, ey equals to minus del v by del y, and Ez equals to minus del V by del Z. All I can see, and this gives you the relationship between the components of electric field and potential, or in general I can put it like this, that electric field is minus or negative gradient of the potential. Now I just verify it for the Cartesian system. So what I do here, I use this. Now if you remember the definition, which is for the Cartesian coordinate system, plus
del V by del Y A by and del V by del Z as N. Now if I look at this, or if I compare this with by comparing these two, I obtain the same result. Okay, so this can be these relations basically can be written in a compact form or can be represented in a compact form by this relation. So this is a general relationship between electric field and electric potential. Okay, now this is what we have done in terms of Cartesian coordinate system. Now can we verify this for the spherical coordinates also? So what we do here, we'll try to calculate the gradient of a potential. So in spherical coordinates, I have V, which is Q over pi epsilon naught R. Okay. Now if I calculate the gradient of V, okay, in spherical coordinates, if I write the definition completely, this is 1 over h1 del v by del u1 a u1, 1 over h2 del v by del u2 a u2, and 1 over h3 del v by del u3 a u3. Okay, now substitute h1 equals to 1, h2 equals to r, h3 equals to r sin theta, u1 equals to r, u2 equals to theta, and u3 equals to phi. So this relation becomes del v by del r ar plus 1 by r del v by del theta a theta plus 1 by r del v by del phi a phi. Okay, this is not r, this is r sin theta. Okay, now substitute the value of v over here. Now you just see here, observe here, the v is only function of r, it is not function of theta and phi. So when I substitute the value of v here, this will contribute because this is partial derivative with respect to r, this is partial derivative with respect to theta. Now when I partially differentiate this v with respect to theta, it gives you 0, as well as with respect to phi, it gives you 0. So these two components will go to 0. So simply this is del of del r of q over 4 pi epsilon naught r into a. Now all other things are constant. 1 by r will become minus 1 by r square a r, and this is in fact minus of E. So this is verified now, that if I calculate the gradient of potential for a point charge in a spherical coordinate system, then the result is negative of electric field. So in general I can say that E equals to that E is 1. So this is the relationship between electric field and potential. And you can generalize this relation for any coordinate system, because for the two systems we have already verified, for Cartesian and spherical coordinate system. But for other coordinates, coordinate systems like cylindrical coordinate system and any other, it is equally true. Okay, so this is what the relationship between electric field and potential. Now the next topic, we'll calculate the electric field due to a dipole. This we have done. Now we'll calculate the electric field due to a dipole, okay, or electric potential due to a dipole. Now when I say dipole, dipole basically is
is an arrangement of two charges. Equal magnitude and opposite type. So you have two charges and they are separated by very separated by a very small distance. Two charges of equal magnitude, opposite type, and separated by a very small distance. Okay. So what we do here for this purpose of calculation of electric potential due to a dipole, we just consider here a configuration of two charges plus Q and minus Q. So I have two charges here, plus Q and minus Q. Okay, and they are along this direction, right? And at the center I have a point which is my origin basically, and the distance between them is d, right? So you have two charges here, Q plus Q, and I am interested in determining the electric potential at a point D. Okay. Now if I connect these points. This is my R1 distance, this is R2 distance, and this is just a mean distance which I call as R. Fine? And this angle I assume as theta. Fine? Now I draw a perpendicular from this point on the line. So this is my perpendicular, or this is 90 degrees. And this distance I can say as R2 minus R1 basically. Okay? Now if I consider this triangle, this right angle triangle, this is R2 minus R1, this is D, and this is perpendicular distance. Okay? So I can simply say this is D cos theta. Fine? The distance between them is D cos theta. Now, if I calculate the potential at this point, and the potential at this point would be potential due to Q plus Q and potential due to minus Q. Okay, so if I write the expression here for the potential V, then this is Q over 4 pi epsilon naught R1 plus minus Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R2. So I can simply write Q 4 pi epsilon naught 1 over R1 minus 1 over R2. Okay. Now if I just try to calculate it, this becomes 4 pi epsilon naught, and this becomes R2 minus R1 divided by R1 R2. Now remember, D is very very small as compared to R, and R1 R2 are almost equals to R. So simply I can say R1 R2 is almost R square. Okay? And R2 minus R1, S from the figure, is D cos theta. Okay? Just now I have calculated using this triangle, and this is D, so this is D cos theta. So now if I substitute these values here, this becomes Q over 4 pi epsilon naught, and this becomes D cos theta over R square. Okay, now I am bringing it here. So V is finally now Q D cos theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R square. Okay. Or now here D, if I write a vector D, then it is D as it, right? So D can be written as a D as it. Then I define a vector P which is Q into D. Fine? Then I can write V as a
cannot be taken out, so this is only present in the first.
So this is how we will write it, 2d by 2 cos theta plus, okay, this is only delta v, sorry. Okay, so E equals, this is the value of del v with a negative sign here. So this negative and this negative will become positive. And this is del v. Okay, so E will become minus of del v. So this becomes qd over 4 pi epsilon naught r square times 2 cos theta. What r cube I have written here? Sorry, this is r square I have taken out. So this is simply r naught ar plus sin theta pi r d theta. Okay, this r can also be taken outside. So this becomes 2 cos theta ar plus sin theta. So this r can be also taken outside. So this r will become. So this is how we can calculate the electric potential and then electric field for an arrangement of two equal and opposite type of charges separated by a small distance, which is known as the electric dipole. So in some of the cases, we first find the electric potential first, and then use this to calculate the electric field. In some of the cases, we calculate the electric field first using the Gauss's law and then determine the potential using the relationship. So whatever the easiest possible approach, looking at the nature of the mathematical complexity, we can choose our approach. We can either calculate potential first or we can find out the electric field first. So this is all about the electric dipole. In the next lecture, we will talk about electrostatic energy and then move on to the next topic, maybe electric polarization and so on. So thank you very much.